So we'll have a look at the two chapters or the two lectures that we covered. The first one was basically on introduction to propulsion systems. So it's an introduction. So on that, I don't want to do any numericals. We will do numericals based on level flight. So the first question is an analytical question. You have to derive something, and that question is about estimation of the velocity that is to be used for level flight. So here is the first question. Okay, there is an aircraft with wing loading W by S. That means the aircraft weight is W and the wing area is S. It is cruising at a fixed altitude, so that means rho is constant, and also the pilot flies it at an angle of attack at that velocity to ensure that its CL by CD is maximum. Given this condition, what should be the velocity of the aircraft to maintain the steady level flight or the cruise flight, assuming a parabolic drag polar, that is CD is equal to CD naught plus KCL square. Remember that the parabolic drag polar is only an assumption. In real life, the drag polar of, or the drag variation of the aircraft is not parabolic. Typically, we see CD naught plus K1 CL square plus K2 CL. There is a K into CL term also, but we ignore it, because by ignoring it, you get a simple expression which can be used to derive some formulae easily. So now the question is open to you. You have to derive the condition for V, the velocity for cruise, such that CL by CD is maximum, and what is that velocity in terms of W by S, in terms of CD naught and in K. So your answer should contain a formula. V for minimum CL by CD is equal to a function of W by S, K and CD naught. So can you please derive the expression? So the way to do this is, first you get the condition for CL by CD maximum. What is the value of CL or V at which CL by CD is maximum? Does anybody know the answer already? What is the condition for CL by CD to be maximum? Yes, please.
CD is 0, that is parasite drag equals to induced drag.
Okay, that's great. So when the two drag terms are going to be equal, that means when CD naught is equal to K, that is the condition. But can you derive this condition? So to derive the condition, what you will do is, you will say that CD is equal to CD naught plus KCL square. Take a partial derivative with respect to CL such that CL by CD is maximum, because you can easily derive it. Okay. So ultimately, as we heard, the condition you will get will be CD naught is equal to K. Okay. Let's just save some time. Let's assume that the optimum condition for CL by CD to be maximum is CD naught is equal to K. If that is the case, now it's very simple to derive the expression for velocity. So please do that. Ultimately, I should get an expression which says V is equal to a function of W by S, CD naught and K. So whenever somebody gets the answer, you just raise your hand. What is your answer? V is equal to
4W square upon C rho square S square by K.
You have to take K. I told you I want the answer in terms of only CD naught, K, W by S and maybe rho. That's all. I don't want to see anything else in the expression. W by S, rho, CD naught and K.
4W square upon CD naught rho square. square s square whole power 1 by 4.
All of it to the power 1 by 4. Then you do it, na? If you have something like square, square and power 4, 1 by 4, you do it, make it little bit more elegant. Your answer may not be wrong, but you can reform it slightly. It's actually very straightforward. You have to just say lift equal to weight. Therefore, W is equal to half rho V square S CL. Okay. So, take S on the denominator on the left hand side, you get W by S is equal to half rho V square CL, and CL is nothing but root of CD naught by K. So, that is it, it is a very straightforward expression. Okay. So, that means if you know the drag polar of the aircraft, that means if you know CD naught and K. And if you know its wing loading, W by S, for a given altitude, you can calculate what is the true airspeed required such that the CL by CD is maximum. And if CL by CD is maximum, then that is the condition corresponding to thrust required is minimum, because we got it from drag required is equal to minimum. Okay, so it is a nice, elegant expression which can be very handy in calculating at what speed should you fly an aircraft so that the thrust required is minimum. Just look at the W by S, which is easily available for every aircraft, CD naught, K and rho. Alright, moving on. The next question is to try and get a variation of thrust available and thrust required at sea level for an actual aircraft. And to do this exercise, I have chosen this very beautiful aircraft called as the Fairchild Republic A-10, or also called as a Warthog. I say it is a beautiful aircraft, but many people find it very ugly. Okay, but as I always say, in war, in combat, we do not have a beauty contest, we have a contest of capability. So, let me present to you, my friends, Fairchild Republic in a war scenario. See how this aircraft can be used to create havoc. I have a question. As this aircraft is drifting away or peeling away, it is throwing out some things. Can you see that? There are some white things coming out from the aircraft. Have you observed? What are these? What are these white things which the aircraft is shedding as it goes into a turn? Yes? Smoke? Smoke flare. What is the smoke flare for? Is the aircraft a smoker? Before going for a fight, let me have a smoke. What is it for? It is not a smoke flare, there is a better word for it. You are near the point, but not exactly. Anybody else? Maybe this side somebody? Yes. Afterburner is afterburner, behind the engine. This is ahead of the engine. See once again. See where is it coming from? And why will it come in pulses? Afterburner will be a continuous continue. You see? It is coming out in pulses. So, it is not a pulse jet, but it is coming in pulses. Okay. Anybody else?
This is the active countermeasure called flares.
Correct.
Used for creating high intensity heat, basically to provide any kind of missiles.
Not any kind of missiles, only the heat seeking missiles. Correct. So, an aircraft that flies low and in the enemy territory for attack is always going to be under the radar of heat seeking missiles. So, these are called as magnesium flares. These are a kind of a safety or a countermeasure. So, to confuse the infrared heat seeking missiles, you throw out magnesium flares. It is also called as a chaff, CHAFF, chaff dispensers. So, you create very high heat source, so the missile can be misguided. Okay, so it's a defense or a safety mechanism. So the aircraft has peeled off and now is going to combat. The Air Force wants to buy the new aircraft F-35, which is very expensive. As you saw, to buy 50 F-35, they had to cancel or retire 300 of these aircraft. And this is very effective. It is doing a lot of good work. So therefore, Senator John McCain says, I will not support this activity of encouraging F-35 and downgrading or retiring A-10. So they have got a new lease of life. They have been refurbished and they are still being used. So there are several interesting design features of this aircraft. But our question today is on performance. Okay? So we will look at a very, very boring thing, that is a steady level flight of Warthog. No combat, no bombs, no missiles. Okay? So we are going to look at this particular aircraft, and these are some of the key characteristics: the wing reference area, the aspect ratio, and the zero lift drag coefficient. Notice that the value of CDO is very high, it is 0.032, whereas the value is normally of the order of 0.02 or even 0.01815 for very smooth aircraft. So this is not a very smooth looking aircraft. It has got lots of appendages which come out because it carries armament. It is meant to carry a lot of armament. So it's not a very pretty aircraft, not aerodynamically very smooth, but doesn't matter. Okay, it has extremely powerful engines, and not one but two of them from reliability point of view. So two jet engines, each of them giving you approximately 40 kilonewtons of static thrust at sea level. So 80 kilonewtons of thrust available at sea level from two engines. The weight of the aircraft is 103,000 newtons. Our job is twofold. We have to plot the power required curve at sea level, and also we have to plot the power available curve at sea level, and hence get the value of the maximum velocity at sea level. Okay, that's our job today. Okay, so to do this, first thing you do is please note down these four or five important things somewhere in your notebook. SW 47 square meters. AR of wing 6.5, CD naught 0.032, the Oswald efficiency factor, or E as it is called, 0.87, W 103,047 newton, and T will be 4298 newton. These numbers please note down. Okay. So how do we do this? We look at some velocity, say 100 meter per second. Is this a realistic number for an aircraft of this type? 100 meter per second, some people are saying no. What is the problem? Is it too high? Yes. But maybe it can fly at this speed. Okay. It's not too high. It's not beyond the expected Vmax. We will know very soon. Whether it can fly or not depends on whether the thrust available is equal to thrust required, or power available equal to power required, or more. Okay. Let's choose a number, 100 meter per second. Okay, so dynamic pressure at sea level for an aircraft which has got a speed of 100 meter per second is half rho v square. Now this is the first place where many students make a mistake. Observe and notice carefully. You are putting density in kg per meter cube, which is 1.225 at sea level. You are putting velocity in meters per second. When you put these numbers, although the density is in kg per meter cube, the answer q infinity will not come in kg per meter square, it will come in newton per meter square. The reason for that is units have to be balanced on both sides. Okay. So q is dynamic pressure, it could be kg per meter square, it could be n per meter square. But you check, density is kg per meter cube, velocity is meter per second. So this is kg per meter cube into meter square per second square. When you cancel the various units, you will find that g or meter per second square remains. So therefore, the answer that you will get will be in newtons per meter square. Many people make this mistake because they have taken kg per meter cube, they think the answer is in kg per meter square. But be careful about these things. So 6125 n by m square is the dynamic pressure at sea level at this velocity. Now the lift coefficient CL for level flight is W by QS, because lift has to be equal to weight. W is in newtons, 103047, Q is 6125, S is 47, these numbers are not going to change, W and S are going to remain the same. So therefore, CL will be 0.358, this is a very appropriate number. CL in level flight normally tends to be approximately between 0.3 to 0.4. So that is a right ballpark, between 0.3 to 0.4 is the expected value of CL for level flight. Once you know the CL, then you know the value of E, which is 0.87, AR, which is 6.5. So therefore, you can get the value of CD. Once you know the value of CD, you can get the value of D, drag, and thrust equal to drag. So the thrust required will be W by CL by CD. Okay, remember there was a mistake in my notes. In my notes, I had shown this thing like a little bit differently, I think. So TR is W by CL by CD. So that is 103047 by CD, CL by CD, which is 9.13, which is 11287 newtons. The thrust required is only 11287 newtons. The thrust available is actually 40,000 into 2, quite a lot. So we are comfortable at this speed. We have much more thrust than required. Power required will be thrust into velocity. Velocity is 100 meter per second. Thrust required is 11287. So the power required will be 11290. So it will be in watts, 1.129 into 10 power 6 watts, or 1129 kilowatts. Okay. So now, in a graph paper or in a sketch, against 100 meter per second on x axis, you have to mark a point, 1129 kilowatts on the y axis. Simple. This is how you get the power required at a given speed for steady level flight. So we have used two conditions here: lift equal to weight, thrust equal to drag. Power available is basically the thrust available into the velocity. Thrust available is going to be given to you, two engines each of 40298. So therefore, it will be 80596 into V infinity in watts, which will be 80.596 kilowatts. I have just divided by 1000. So total power available is 80 kilowatts. So at 100 meter per second, at 100 meter per second, the velocity of 100 will give you 8059 kilowatts. Required 1127, available 8059. Required is only 1/8 of available. So absolutely no problem. Okay. So now we need to repeat this for other velocities. So I'll just show you what we have already obtained for one particular speed. Correct. So now we have to take a guess. At this speed, power available is 8 times power required roughly, and the power required is proportional to V cube. So we need to take a guess up to what number we can go, but we do not know a priori. Our job is to find out where it is maximum. So what we can do is take some rough numbers. So I have just taken numbers 130, 160, 190. So now each one of you have a choice of any two velocities. Just write down on your notebook the number. Choose any number between 130, 160, 190, 220, 250, 280, 310. You can choose some other number also, but then you cannot verify, because for these I have the values. So you can verify. Okay. So pick up any two numbers. Any two velocities of your choice, and what you do is fill up this table for your aircraft, for your operating condition. Also, there is one more column to be put, which is the power available. At sea level, we assume that the power available is not going to change much with the velocity. power available will change. Why? It will be proportional to velocity. So it's a sea level. So the maximum value remains the same. Just multiply by the velocity you have chosen. So put one more column where you have P available in kilowatts. Okay. So this is an exercise for individuals, but you have a choice of two velocities, whatever numbers you like. The first thing you need to calculate is dynamic pressure, for which density is the same but velocities are different. So Sushil, what velocities have you chosen?
Three ten.
Okay, that's it, one velocity. So I said choose two velocities. So at 310, do you get thrust power required more than power available? Which means that you have crossed the maximum speed. So we have one hint from Sushil. If his calculations are right, which I assume will be, then the maximum velocity is below 310. Okay. So Sushil, take 280 maybe, because 310 is more than what your aircraft can handle. 310 meter per second would be almost near Mach 1. Mach 1 is 330 or 340. Okay. So 330 and 310 means you are almost near Mach number 1. In other words, it seems that this aircraft cannot fly supersonic at sea level. But please note, this is not an exact calculation, this is a small example. Small example for the classroom purposes. So do not take it literally that these numbers are perfectly correct. Also remember one more thing, that CD equal to CD naught plus K CL square is actually a parabolic approximation. If you reach very high Mach numbers near 1, for example, there will be other drag terms which will come into play. You will have probably a critical Mach number much before 0.9. So therefore, this particular simplistic calculation may not be applicable, but nevertheless, we want to use it for the classroom purposes. Okay, anybody else? Have you finished two velocities? You have finished. Which ones have you chosen? 220 and 310. Okay. Okay, so you have for three velocities now. So are you confirming to me that the aircraft can fly at 280? Power, so which is more? PA is more, which means the maximum velocity is slightly more than 280. No, more than 280, na? More than 280. Does anybody know what is the maximum velocity? You cannot. It will be more than 280, less than 310, unless somebody does for 300. Okay. So let us see the table now. Okay, look at the numbers. I have the numbers only for power required. Power available, I do not have the numbers here. So check for the numbers against the velocity which you have chosen. If the numbers are not matching, then please look at your calculations. So is there anybody who has a difference of opinion? So are these numbers okay, at least for your velocity? They seem to be okay. So we notice that the CL by CD is actually maximum at 100 itself amongst the numbers given. As the velocity increases beyond 100, CL by CD is reducing. So it may be worthwhile to try 80 meter per second as a velocity. Maybe at that velocities you may have a CL by CD higher than 9.13. We don't know. It is a matter of just calculating. Okay. So this is something you can try out yourself. In fact, what you can do, write a small code, and using that code you can calculate the value of power available and power required and then plot the graph. What will be nice if somebody can upload on Moodle the value of P required, P available for velocities from say 10 meter per second, that will be too less I think, something like say 20 to 25 meter per second, to the maximum value at sea level. Okay. So whoever wants to do it just to brush up their knowledge can do it and upload. So this is the, yes, yes, there is a question.
Can we assume that drag equals the maximum thrust we can provide and then do it from behind?
You can do that also, but how do you know? Yeah, you can do that to get the value, but then you will get two answers. You will get a lower value and the higher value, so you can take the higher of the two. Yes, you can do that. If your question is just to find the velocity at which you can fly max, you don't have to do all this. You can do it directly by a single equation. But I wanted to see the plot because I want to look at many more things. For example, I also want to know what is the velocity to fly at which thrust required is minimum? What is the velocity required at which the power required is minimum? I want to confirm that CL by CD is actually minimum. And I am more curious. I also want to plot CL 3 by 2 by CD. And I want to confirm that CL 3 by 2 by CD is also maximum or a minimum at a particular value. Okay. So that is why I want you to do this. So here is the graph for power available versus power required for this example. For speeds below 100, we have not drawn it because we have not taken it up, but you could do it, and with that we get the intersection at around 295 meter per second. So by this very simplistic calculation, the maximum speed of the aircraft at sea level will be 295 meter per second. Actual value will be less than this because the drag will increase very rapidly. Maybe this velocity is more than the critical Mach number, so therefore the drag will rise rapidly. So roughly this value can be considered. Okay. Let's look at what happens to the same thing at a higher altitude. So question number 3 is, everything else remaining same, just change the altitude of operation as 5000 meters. So earlier you had a thrust required and thrust available at sea level. Now we want thrust required and available at a height of 5000 meters. So to do this, we need to know two things. One thing we need to know is, what is the density of air at 5000 meters? Now this is a number which you can actually calculate, because if you assume ISA conditions, which we have to assume, unless it is stated explicitly in the question, you can assume the conditions to be ISA. Okay, whenever there is a question, if not mentioned, you have to assume ISA. So under ISA conditions, how will you find density of air at 5000 meters? What is the procedure you will follow?
Sir, we know that the temperature change last rate is minus 6.5 Kelvin per kilometer.
Okay, under ISA conditions, I agree that temperature drops at the rate of 6.5 degrees per kilometer. Fine.
And we have formula rho by rho 1 equal to T by T1. Power minus
G0
by lab into R plus 1.
Ha. So this whole formula, just to memorize it, under ISA conditions, it becomes T by T0 to the power 5.258.
So we know
T1. Yeah. So what is T1? What is T0?
T0 is what? Temperature
at
sea level conditions and
we know
density at sea level conditions.
How much T0 at sea level?
288
degree Kelvin. And density? 1.225 or 1.2256 kg per meter cube. Correct. Very good. So you know T naught, you know rho naught. You can get T1 by subtracting 6.5 degrees per kilometer, and this subtraction is acceptable till 11 kilometers. From 11 to 25 it remains constant. Above that, don't bother, it's not aeronautical, it is space. Okay. So it's very simple. Up to 11 kilometers, reduce 6.5 degree per kilometer, and T by T naught to the power 5.256 will give you the value of density. So that number comes to, you can just cross check this please quickly. 288.16 minus 6.5 into 5 upon 288.16 to the power 5.258 should be 0.7634. That will give you the ratio. And that ratio into 1.2256 should give you 1.73. Just check it. Right. So density of air at sea level is known. So 5 kilometers is known. Now we have to assume, you have to assume something now. We have to assume some variation of power required, velocity and temperature. So, temperature we do not have to assume, we know it is the variation like this. Now, you may not need this. You can say, I do not want to worry. I will take the value of V true at some altitude and calculate the value of CL, then K, then CD, then T, and then P. Okay.